let me introduce our speaker today. Dr. Engineer Grzegorz Kowzan received his bachelor and a master diploma from Nicolaus Copernicus University in Toruń, where he continued his education under supervision of Professor Piotr Masłowski. So he was developing a broadband frequency comb for spectroscopy techniques. He was also working on a molecular line shape theory. He was awarded Palladium Research Grant, then a TUDA scholarship. Then he defended his PhD thesis in 2020 with honors, also at Nicolaus Copernicus Center. And then he moved to Stony Brook University. He's working with Professor Thomas Allison. And recently, he was awarded the prestigious Marie Skłodowska-Curie Individual Fellowship to develop multidimensional gas phase optical spectroscopies at Stony Brook University. But during this fellowship, he's also obliged to go to Poland. So Grzegorz, the screen is yours, please.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so good morning to everyone. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. And thank you for moving the presentation, the time of presentation by an hour, since actually, since January, I'm actually working at Stony Brook University in person in Department of Chemistry. So as you can see, this is, I finished my PhD in physics from Nicolaus Copernicus University, and now I'm working in Department of Chemistry. And this is because the field in which I'm working is actually physical chemistry, chemical physics, depending on from which side you're looking at it. And the research and the things I'm going to present today are going to be highly on the experimental and not on the theoretical side of physics and chemistry. So with that, I would like to start. And first, I wanted to give a short introduction to what is ultrafast spectroscopy and what kind of physical and chemical information we actually receive from it. So ultrafast spectroscopy tries to study processes, molecular and physical and biological processes on the time scale of down to a single femtoseconds. So as you can see here, if we want to study molecular vibrations of molecular mode, or any processes which strongly involve vibrational motion of molecules, then we should be, time resolution of our measurements should be below the periods of vibrational oscillations. And that means that we have to have our time revolution on the time resolution on the order of tens, maybe hundreds of femtoseconds. On the other hand, if you want to focus on rotational motion of the molecules, we are actually fine with time resolution and measurements on the order of picoseconds or sometimes even nanoseconds. And you can also see that there's a variety of physical, chemical, and biological processes we can study. So we will be looking at, in a short while, at proton transfer and internal conversion, but also at vibrational relaxation. In general, the ultrafast spectroscopic techniques are used for systems which are as small as diatomic molecule or a single atom, to systems which are very large, such as DNA strands and other important biological systems. And also I wanted to mention that here we are focusing on the femtosecond dynamics. So we are going to motions as short, as quick as vibrational motions. But in principle, if you want to focus on mostly electronic dynamics, then you should actually go to even shorter time scales. And this is also something that is often called attochemistry. where we try to produce attosecond pulses and then study electron dynamics. And the one of the pioneers of this field was Ahmed Zeweil, which won the Nobel Prize in 1999 for doing the initial important initial studies using ultrafast lasers. So one of the most well studied molecule and dynamics in ultrafast spectroscopy is a simple molecule. It's iodine, the atomic molecule. Here we can see potential energy surfaces of this molecule, depending on the, so this is the energy of the system depending on the spacing between the iodine atoms. And you can see the in the ground electronic state labeled as X, strongly bound a potential which will support strong bound states. You can also see that depending on the specifics of the excitation that we're going to introduce, we can excite the system into another bound state B, but we can also excite the system into states which cannot support bound states and which will lead to dissociation of the molecule. And we will see how we can actually track the real-time dynamics of these kind of processes with ultrashort pulses. So the simplest example of such ultra-fast experiment is shown here, where we have our sample. So in this case, we would have a gas phase sample of iodine molecules. And we have our first pulse, pump pulse, which will transfer some population from the ground electronic and vibrational state into a coherent superposition of different vibrational and rotational states in some excited electronic state. And then we will wait some time and interact with the sample with another probe pulse. And in this experiment that I'm showing here, what the probe pulse did is that it excited the molecule once again into a state which strongly fluoresced. So that meant that the time-dependent dynamics were measured essentially by varying the time delay and looking at the fluorescence signal after the sample absorbed the probe pulse. And you can also essentially see from this potential energy plot that depending on where exactly the wave packet that we excited will be, so depending on the time dynamics after the excitation, the gap between the energy curve that we probe and this excited state will be different. And also depending on where exactly we are on this, so that means that we will need to tune the pump wavelength to decide where exactly we want to excite our state. But that also means that when the highly excited state will fluoresce, the wavelength of the fluorescence may also depend on the time of our at which we do the measurements. So specializing our investigations, we can first consider the case where we are tuned to this B state. So what will happen is that we will excite a wave packet here. We will have the wave packet will be in this excited electronic state and in a superposition of different vibrational and rotational state. And by varying the time delay, we will see essentially oscillations of the molecular coherence in this excited state. So if you are to simulate this process, the way you could simulate it numerically is you could say that you start with a Gaussian wave packet in this region, and then you propagate the evolution of the wave packet in time under the influence of this potential. Well, and what you would see is that you would have the wave packet expanding and going back and forth in this potential well. And then and then that would mean that depending on the phase of this movement of the wave packet, we will all the either the probe pulse will be in phase with the movement or out of phase, and depending on the on where exactly the wave packet is in this potential well, we will either have constructive or destructive interference. And this is what we see here. Essentially, the spacing between fringes is given by the spacing between vibrational levels in this excited state. And the beat note pattern is due to the fact that we excite several different vibrational states, but also due to the fact that that our potential is unharmonic and the spacing between vibrational states is not the same all the time. So you can also, so here the measurements were done up to a few tens, around 15 picoseconds. But if you actually took the measurements for much longer time at the time scale of few hundreds of picoseconds, then you would also see the rotational dynamics of this sample. So the way it works is that essentially when we excite the molecule, then the interaction between the laser pulse and the molecule depends on the relative alignment of the molecule to the polarization axis of our pulse. So that means that it is more probable to excite the molecule when the transition dipole is aligned with the polarization of the sample. So we initially start with an aligned sample after the excitation. We excite many different rotational states, and these rotational states are separated by the rotational constant of our molecule, which essentially tells us what's the moment of inertia of our molecule. And that means that after a period which corresponds to this moment of inertia passes, we will see all the rotational states which we excited be in phase or out of phase. And that will create this kind of rotational coherence revivals, which tell us from which we can derive the moments of inertia of our molecule. So this is essentially what you can see when you do this kind of experiment and the molecule lands in the bound state. But we can also tune our wavelength to a lower energy, which here would correspond to this repulsive potential. And then what we could see is we could see in real time essentially the movement of this wave packet, and in the end the dissociation of the molecule. And this is essentially tracked here, where we have initial strong pulse because we excited this wave packet here, and then we excite it again. But you can see that very rapidly the signal decays to the fact that the molecule dissociates. And also based on the fact that we still see some weak oscillations, we can conclude that we partially excite the wave packet in this repulsive wall, but also for this wavelength, we still create some coherence in this bound excited state. So this is one example of the measurements we can do with ultrafast spectroscopy. Another thing which we actually recently performed in Stony Brook is so-called excited state intramolecular proton transfer. So in this case, we have, for example, this kind of molecule. We start with ground electronic state, and then we excite the molecule to the first excited electronic state. And what can happen when we increase the energy of the system is that this hydrogen can transfer from oxygen to nitrogen. So this process can happen very quickly, on the order of below 100 femtoseconds. So this is actually quite difficult to measure the dynamics of the process. But what happens afterwards is that the essentially the structure of the molecule changed. And that means that where before we had some geometry of the molecule which was energetically optimal, now this the same geometry is not optimal because we changed the structure. So that means that when the molecule relaxes from the excited state after the proton transfer, the ground state will be different. So when we look at this from the perspective of pump probe spectroscopy, we can see that when we excite the molecule with some ultraviolet photon, the proton transfers, but then the fluorescence after this internal conversion will be at a different wavelength. So essentially, if we use pump probe spectroscopy, then we can track this structural realignment of the molecule after the proton is transferred to a different part of the molecule. And this is also actually an interesting process from the point of view of biological applications, because it is thought to be important for photostability of the of organic molecules, which means that which are essentially the processes that cause the molecule to not break apart when it excites a high energetic ultraviolet photon. But we can, so these were two examples of pump probe spectroscopy, where we have two pulses. But we can go one step further, and we can use three very short pulses. So again, we have our first pulse, we wait some time, then we have our second pulse, then we wait some time again, and we have our third pulse. So if we did measurements where we varied all these three time scales, then we can think of it, and then we can say that this first molecule, for example, excites this vibrational mode, and then we wait some time, and we track the evolution of the coherence that we created in this molecule, and then we perform a Fourier transform of this of the signal that we record, depending on the waiting time between the first and the second pulse. So that would give us one of the frequency axes of our measurement. Then we wait some time between the second and the third pulse, and then we measure the emission, the molecular polarization that we created within the molecule. And this will give us our second probe frequency axis. So we have an example here, a quite typical example here of a 2D spectroscopic measurement. We have our CO bond in a complicated molecule. And this CO bond decompose the vibrations of this CO bond into asymmetric and symmetric vibrations, and we can excite them with our laser pulses. So looking at the linear spectra, we could see two different absorption bands, and then when you looked at the dependence at the two-dimensional signal, what we see is that on the diagonal, we essentially see a copy of this linear absorption spectrum. So we have our asymmetric and symmetric stretch absorption. But then what can happen is that first we excite from the ground vibrational state to the excited vibrational state. And then the next pulse can also excite from the first excited state to the second excited state. And this is what we see on the as the off-diagonal absorption bands, which are shifted from ground to first excited state transition, because we have the potential is in general unharmonic, and the energy levels are not equally spaced. But what we can also see here on the outside the diagonal is that the absorption of the molecule depends on essentially the motion of the two vibrational modes. It's coupled, and the motion is dependent on each other. So that means that if we first excite on the asymmetric stretch, and then we excite the symmetric stretch, we see that we have a signal on the anti-diagonal part of the spectrum, and that means that we cannot completely separate the motion of the molecule in this 2 degrees of freedom. And this is a typical kind of two-dimensional experiment which allows us to look at the dynamics after a ultra-short excitation. So we can also see at a more complicated example. So this is an example of in liquid water. When we look at isolated water molecule, then you can easily find that we have asymmetric and symmetric vibrations of the molecule around 3600 wave numbers. And we can also have bending vibrations of these two hydrogens relative to the oxygen. So you would expect in linear spectrum two absorption bands. So one we have here and the symmetric stretch and the band we have here. And I guess if you look back to the previous slide, then what you would expect is you would have this kind of thing where we have at 1600 the band absorption, at 3700 the stretch absorption, and possibly if the motions are correlated, then you would see some cross peak. But other than that, the spectrum should be clean because we do not expect the molecule to absorb at any other part of the spectrum. But what we actually see in liquid water is that after exciting the symmetric stretch vibration, we essentially see after that absorption all over the infrared spectral range from 1600 to 3600 inverse centimeters. And well, first of all, we see a correlation between exciting the symmetric stretch and the band, but we also see this broad induced absorption in the sample. And the accepted interpretation of this result is that essentially when you have a liquid water, then we do not have isolated water molecules, but we have water, weakly bound water clusters. And when we create some kind of vibrational excitation in these water clusters, then we create a strongly delocalized excitation which can travel around this cluster, which essentially strongly mixes band and stretch vibrations. And this causes this kind of this strong response of the water cluster network at frequencies at which it wouldn't usually respond if we didn't excite it previously. So what is very, very also, so what is also easy to see based on this kind of investigation is that this effect should strongly depend on the size of the cluster. Because here we have a liquid water sample, but you can imagine the kind of experiment where we have this kind of gas phase water molecules, and we see what happens in this kind of experiment for a water dimer. So a cluster created from two molecules, then we could see what happens with the water trimer, and further on increasing the size of the system. And this we expect would help us very much in actually figuring out what exactly happens in such water cluster networks. So this is an interesting experiment that we would like to do, but the toolbox of physical chemistry or chemical physics has a way to do these kind of experiments. So what you usually do when you have some sample which is in liquid phase in room temperature and you want to measure its gas phase dynamics is that you use you have some high pressure bottle of noble carrier gas. You have the container with the sample And then you put a very strong pressure flow through this container, which picks up these liquid phase molecules and drags them to this experimental chamber, which is a container held under vacuum. So what happens when this flow reaches this vacuum chamber is that it rapidly cools down, and we have a cold gas phase molecular sample in which we can then study the dynamics. So this kind of experiment was actually done for heavy water. And you can see that for free OD stretch region means that we would have a free water molecules which are not in any kind of water cluster. But you can see that then, depending on the size of the cluster, the absorption strongly changes. So this was done for, this is essentially a linear spectroscopic measurement. And this one was done quite a while ago. There are many ways actually to do very sensitive measurements when we're talking about linear spectroscopy. But the problem for nonlinear spectroscopy is that the densities of this sample are very low. And it is not, and by nature, the ultrafast measurements are, optical ultrafast measurements are much less sensitive than linear spectroscopy measurements. So nevertheless, there are ways around that. And one of the ways to measure the ultrafast dynamics of very dilute samples is use something called time-resolved photoelectron spectroscopy. So in this case, what happens is that we again have some short optical pulses. We can excite some vibrational states, wait a while between the pulses, or we can excite electronic states, then wait some time between the subsequent pulses. But the last step is that we ionize the molecule. So we, for example, would like to study some vibrational dynamics, but since our sensitivity is not good enough, we ionize the molecule, and then we can do very sensitive measurements of free electrons and ions. So this is a quite successful technique. But the problem is that we're not actually measuring directly what we want to measure, because we're not directly measuring the vibrational dynamics. We are measuring the dependence, the projection of the vibrational state under the state of ion and free electron. And it is not at all trivial to simulate, to predict how the state of the ion and free electron that we would measure depends on the vibrational state of the molecule. So in some sense, you could say that first you did measurements in solution phase which are purely optical, and then you did photoionization measurements in gas phase, then you're kind of comparing apples to oranges, because if you see a difference between these two measurements, then you're not quite sure if this is because here you had gas phase and here you had solution phase, or if this is because here you actually didn't ionized the molecule and the molecule was not strongly perturbed. And in this case, you strongly change the nature of the observable that you measure. So ideally, we would like to do purely optical measurements where the molecule stays intact and in the gas phase, because then we can compare both with this solution phase experiments and with these gas phase experiments, but with photoionization. So when it comes to linear spectroscopy, there are actually well known and well developed techniques to increase the sensitivity. And so with this, I will proceed to the cavity enhanced part of our ultrafast spectroscopy. So if you want to significantly increase the sensitivity of our measurements, then we go to the world of very precise and very accurate optical measurements. And we want to use a frequency code. So compared to our previous situation, when we just did ultra-fast measurements, what we cared about is that the pulse was ultra-short. And also it would be nice if the pulse was also high power, because we would like to excite a significant fraction of the sample. But we didn't care about the coherence of the time phase coherence of our laser beam. So what this means is that frequency comp is generated by a train of ultra short pulses. But the key point is that the time separation between these pulses is kept constant all the time. And also the phase shift between the carrier wave and the envelope is also very well defined. So if we have such a train of ultra short, very regular pulses, then in the frequency domain, you can see that it corresponds to a comb of frequencies, which are essentially described by the repetition rate. So the spacing in time domain between the pulses and the quantity, which depends on this phase offset between the envelope and the carrier. And what is also very nice, and what was the reason for development of these kind of light sources, was that you can essentially describe this whole spectrum by two radio frequencies, which can actually be very precisely controlled and measured with standard electronic equipment. So when this kind of light sources were developed, they are used for very precise optical frequency measurements, such as the optical atomic clocks, where they are essentially one of the essential ingredients of the whole experimental setup. But also you can use this kind of very stable at broadband light sources to do spectroscopic measurements. And this is what I did during my PhD work at Nicolaus Copernicus University. Essentially, we had our broadband light source, we had some kind of gas cell, and then we had a spectrograph. And then we measured these kind of broadband spectra. So from the point of view of our ultra-fast measurements, what we want to use the frequency comps for is that we want to increase the sensitivity of our measurements. So what we want to do is we want to do an optical cavity, which is a Fabry-Perron interferometer. So this is essentially a pair of mirrors with high reflection coefficient. And then if we have a light incident on this pair of mirrors, then if the spacing between the mirrors is an integer multiple of the wavelength of the light, then we will have constructive interference. And we can say then that the light is resonant with the optical cavity. And if this resonance condition is not met, then we will have strong destructive interference. So what this means from the point of view of an absorbing sample present in between these two mirrors is that effectively the interaction length between the light inside the cavity and the sample can be increased by a factor proportional, by a factor related to the reflection coefficient of the mirrors. And that means that in practice, we can extend our sensitivity by tens of thousands, by a factor of tens of thousands, going from path length of around 1 meter to effective path lengths of kilometers. And then looking in frequency domain, what we see is that we have our cavity modes, and we can actually essentially match the resonance structure of the optical cavity to our frequency comp, which will cause the optical frequency comp to be transmitted through the cavity and the absorption to be enhanced. So this is an example of such measurements where we measured absorption of carbon monoxide in room temperature. We also did measurements, one of the most precise measurements with with a broadband spectroscopic measurements where we measured the shape of optical resonances of a cavity with a precision of few hertz. And we can use this kind of techniques also to increase the sensitivity of our ultrafast measurements. So in linear spectroscopy, we have this kind of situation where we have two mirrors in our sample. And the way to expand it, for example, to ultrafast measurements is that you can simply have another frequency comb laser. You synchronize the delay between these two frequency comb lasers. And what you would get in this case is that you excite the sample with the pump pulses. And just as before with pump probe spectroscopy, you see that you look at the dynamics after the excitation. But this time, since the sample and the pulse is in a cavity, you obtain a strong enhancement of the detected signal. So what we would actually like to do also is, well, we enhance the absorption signal, but we would also like to use the same kind of technique for the pump pulses. And we can also do that. We can essentially create two optical cavities, put them at this kind of configuration where they have a common focus. We can also put the flow of cold molecules in the crossing region, and then varying the delay between these pulses, we can do ultrasensitive measurements. So when it comes to probe absorption, we can think of it as increase of effective path length. But when it comes to pump pulses, essentially the power circulating inside the cavity is enhanced also by a factor related to the reflectivity of the mirrors. So at the reasonable finesse values of a few hundreds, we get few orders of magnitude enhancement compared to standard pump probe spectroscopy. So I also wanted to mention that actually when you look at a lot of this kind of work to develop this kind of system is technical, because when you do standard ultrafast spectroscopy measurements, then you mostly care about short pulse durations. When you do linear spectroscopy measurements, then you don't actually care how long the pulse is. You care that it's very stable. But for our case, we actually need the strong phase coherence, short pulse duration, and we also need high average powers. And that means that essentially we can't use commercial equipment, but we have to develop our own light sources. And another thing which is important for us is that for linear spectroscopy, we also don't really care that much if the pulse circulating inside the cavity will be short or not. But for our ultrafast measurements, well, if the pulses are not going to be short inside the cavity, then we can do the measurement. And that means that we also have to be careful about the kind of optical cavity mirrors we use, because depending on the details of how the mirrors are produced, they could potentially strongly broaden our pulse in time and make our measurements impossible. So we have actually, so before I came to Stony Brook, these kind of measurements were done. The Tom Allison and his coworkers at Stony Brook University developed their own light sources. They created a light source emitting in the green light, and they did a demonstration measurements of the iodine molecule. So this is essentially the same kind of dynamics that I showed on one of the first slides. And you can see the dynamics that I discussed before. But this was essentially a proof of concept demonstration. What this allowed them to show is that, in fact, with this cavity enhancement, we go down to densities which are so low that we can measure gas phase clusters of cold molecules, but the problem was that they were only able to measure the dynamics at a single wavelength. So the natural extension in which I was already involved was to build a very broad light sources. So here essentially we have this broad tunable frequency comp, which covers all the visible range from 400 to 700 nanometers, which also have a very short pulse durations. Then we actually had to show that this kind of broadly tunable comp can be coupled to the cavity and that we could maintain the short duration of the pulses. So this was also done relatively recently. And finally, we assembled this whole setup where we can do this kind of broadband, ultra-fast, and ultra-sensitive measurements. So very recently, we actually did study the dynamics of this excited state intramolecular proton transfer in a molecule like this. So we saw two interesting things. We did see a difference when we compared the change in the absorption after the excitation for gas phase and for liquid phase. Then we did see a difference, but it wasn't actually that significant. The only thing that changed was that the absorption was slightly shifted in frequencies. And this was simply because in the liquid sample, the solvent interacts with the perturbs the internal molecular energy levels, and this shifts the transition frequencies of the sample. But what we actually found was that while the relaxation time in our gas phase optical measurements and in solution phase optical measurements was very close, the relaxation time in time result photoelectron measurements was twice as short. So it seems that when you compare actually apples to apples, then you get very close measurements between gas phase and solution phase. But when you use photoelectron techniques, you perturb the system strongly enough that you're actually measuring quite a different thing when you project the state of your system on a state of ion electron. We have also done similar measurements for another molecule. So in this case, we have also a possible transfer of proton to this nitrogen. But what the molecule can do after excitation is that it can essentially rotate around this axis. And depending on the relative alignment of these two parts of the molecule, the proton transfer is either more or less probable. And what we saw when we used different kind of noble carrier gases, was that when we use high pressure argon carrier gas, we essentially obtained much longer time dependent signal. And as I mentioned before, one of the things you can see from this time-dependent signal is the rotational coherence signal, which is proportional to, which is dependent on the moments of inertia of the sample. So we hypothesize that essentially what happens is that argon atoms stick to this molecule and freeze out the movement of this kind of internal rotation of the molecule. And what also happens is that since now we have a big blob of cold argon atoms around this kind of molecule, the moment of inertia changes and the rotational component of the signal changes. And we were able to do some simple estimation that around 20 to 30 argon atoms cluster on this molecule to freeze out the dynamics. And similarly to the previous molecule, we also saw that the so-called lifetimes also agree between the transient absorption spectrum in solution phase but they do not agree with transient absorption in time-resolved photoelectron spectrum. So this seems to become a pattern where the photoelectron spectra lifetimes for some reason are much shorter, but our next steps will be to to perform this kind of measurements on more molecular systems and to work with quantum chemists to obtain some kind of theoretical explanation and theoretical prediction why we have this significant difference between time-resolved photoelectron dynamics and all optical dynamics. So do I have any more time actually?
Yes, there are still 10 minutes left.
Okay, so this is essentially our last results, which we are also want to expand to another measurements. But the topic of my Marii Skłodowska-Curie fellowship would be actually to develop the cavity-enhanced two-dimensional spectrometer. So I actually skipped previous year a lot of details of how these kind of experiments work. In general, if you want to, the common way to approach this from theoretical perspective is to solve the Maxwell wave equation for a nonlinear polarization, and then to express the macroscopic polarization of the sample, which is produced by the ultrashort pulses, in terms of time-dependent perturbation expansion of density matrix of your system. So in the end, what we obtain is that our generated third order signal is this kind of nested commutator, which describes the subsequent interaction of three pulses through a dipole interaction with our sample. And what we can also see is that depending on the specific pattern of excitations of our sample, the generated signal can be emitted in different directions, where K1, K2, and K3 are the wave vectors of our three incident pulses. And you can see that with this kind of most general geometry where we have three pulses, the generated signals can be spatially separated. So one thing you can also see is that through all this talk, I assume that the signal that we're measuring is the signal created by excitation of the sample, single excitation of the sample by the first pulse, by the second pulse, and by the third pulse. But what can actually happen is that in terms of perturbation theory excitations, we can obtain a signal where the first two excitations were done by the first sample. And for example, the third excitation was done by the second sample. And then we would have this kind of signal here. Or we could obtain a signal which essentially was only dependent on the first pulse, and the first pulse did three of these perturbations of the system. But the problem is that actually we are most of the time interested in the signal, which is related to the interaction with all the three pulses. So we are interested in this signal, and in this signal, but all the other signals are usually not of interest. And this means that this is one of the reasons why measurements are often done is this kind of geometry, because you can then spatially separate all the signals generated from the sample. So then we would like to do a similar kind of measurements with frequency comps in optical cavities. And when we actually see relate this formula to what happens with frequency comps, then we also see that the different directions are also are connected also to the relative phases, to the phase of the generated optical wave, which also depend on the relative phases of the three incident pulses. So in terms of our frequency comb, that means that the offset frequency of the generated third order signal of our frequency comb will depend on these offset frequencies of the incident combs. So that means that essentially if we want to do cavity enhanced measurements, then we would have to resonantly enhance four different optical frequency combs in a single cavity, which seems to be a problem because what I showed before is that we can match the resonance structure of optical cavity to one frequency comb, but it seems to be much more difficult to do the same for multiple frequency combs in a single cavity. But thankfully, there's a way to do that. So the way we can do that is that we can notice that actually depending on the transverse profile of our optical beam, the cavity will add a phase shift to the beam purely dependent on the transverse profile and the geometry of the cavity. So that means that varying the transverse profile of our incident beams, we can essentially excite independent sets of resonances in the same cavity. And what we can also do is we can essentially adjust the way we fill the cavity modes in such a way that the generated signal will be produced in one of the cavity modes, one of the family of cavity modes, or the incident signals will be in other sets of cavity modes. And all the signals that I mentioned are the ones that we do not want to measure, would actually fall outside the resonance structure of the cavity modes and would be strongly suppressed, even though in principle they still are generated and they are emitted in the same direction as all the other signals. But the use of the cavity would allow us to strongly suppress them, and on top of that, to strongly enhance the signals which are resonant with the cavity. So this is going to be a part of my work. And I just wanted to mention that we actually have partially verified that with this kind of two-dimensional cavity enhanced scheme, we can also expect very strong cavity enhancement and very low noise level, which would allow us to do these kind of very sensitive measurements, and that we already have the kind of technology we need to generate the light sources needed for these kind of measurements. And I guess I'm running out of time, so I would also like to mention that one of the motivations other than studying the water cluster dynamics is to measure high resolution gas phase samples. Here we have an example congested spectrum of many different organic compounds, which you can find in human breath under exposure to influenza. So you can see that these kind of spectrum are very congested and that it might be quite difficult based on these kind of measurements. What are the concentrations of different constituents? If we look at the kind of spectra we would obtain with two-dimensional spectroscopy, then we actually essentially project this information on a two independent degrees of freedom. And this should allow us to much more easily distinguish different components of the mixture. And one part of my work is also to simulate this kind of two-dimensional gas phase rotational release of spectra. So one of the interesting results we have found was that with our free samples, by adjusting the relative polarizations of the beams, we can selectively suppress different parts of the nonlinear rotational response of the molecule to more easily identify the components of the mixture. Yes, okay. So with this, I would like to finish and I can take any questions. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for this presentation. And now we have time for questions.
May I start?
Sure.
Okay, it was very impressive, of course. I'm sorry I missed about first minutes for some reason, but I don't know how much did you say about the history of this tracing dynamics of quantum wave packets with the pump probe experiments. One of the very first achievements in this direction was done by Carlos Stroud in Rochester in early 90s. Did you mention this maybe? Probably not. I will just
focused on the work by Ahmed Zeweil on iodine.
No. The early thing is really by Carlos. And what he did, he traced the dynamics of Rydberg wave packets in the isolated atom, right? So he could trace the Keplerian motion of such a wave, concentrated wave packet, and also looked at the spreading of this wave packet, which I think was beautiful experiment, very much in line with what you are telling us about the molecular dynamics. Mm-hmm. That was, as I remember, was must have been early 90s of last century, about 30 years ago. At the same time, also molecular experiments started, and some chemists started also tracing the dynamics in the molecules, the atoms forming molecules, and tracing the interatomic potential with various pump probe pulses. And I remember seeing even movies of such a dynamics made out of the results of such measurement. Okay, that was a remark, not a question.
So maybe next questions, maybe I can ask, because the fact you are studying these dynamical processes, but before that you have to be assured about very precise control over concerning frequencies. Mm-hmm. So does it mean that you can, using your setup, maybe contribute to measurement of some fundamental constants or very precise measurement of molecular energy levels?
Yeah, okay, so that would actually be this part with linear spectroscopy. So, essentially, if the frequency comps are essential when you want to do this ultra precise measurements, with optical techniques, then nowadays you basically always use a frequency comp because this gives you the frequency reference of your measurement. But
there is some advantage of your setup because you gain with this high finesse. Yes, you have high finesse. Am I correct?
Yes. So for this kind of, for example, in Nicolaus Copernicus University, like one of the things that are done is that they have the cavity with ultra high finesse, and they measure the energy levels of hydrogen molecules. But for this kind of measurements, actually, what you want is you want to a single wavelength laser and very, very high finesse cavity. So you don't need to measure the nonlinear dynamics, the time dependence, if the only thing you need are energy levels. Mm-hmm. You can just do linear absorption measurements, and this is going to be much easier and better than this kind of ultra-fast dynamical measurements.
Okay,
thanks. Because for this precision physics measurements, we care about the positions of energy levels and not about the dynamics, like what would happen if I excite the vibration mode of hydrogen molecule, and then, for example, I ionize it. That really isn't that won't give me the information I need for this.
So thank you. Are there any other questions? If there is no more question, let's thank the speaker again.